Hey y'all, so let me share a story with you for a second. So I have a grandson named Caden. He's 9 months old, and we just celebrated his first Christmas with him, which was wonderful. And as we were going into Christmas, what I wanted to do is find some toys to get for him, right? That's what grandparents do. We buy toys for our grandkids. So I was looking online for some toys, and I found this great toy called My Sports Bag. And it was this soft toy bag that in it had a baseball, a basketball, a football, and a soccer ball, like toy size for little kids. So I thought this is gonna be perfect because this will be his first introduction to sports. We're kind of a sports family, and but they're soft and they're toys, so he can start to play with them and get used to throwing them and stuff. Well, so I ordered it. I was so excited. I sent away for it, waited for it to come, and then finally it came, and I was so excited. I ripped open the box, and y'all, this is what came, my sports bag. So y'all, this is tiny. Let me show you the football really quick. This is the football, okay? Totally adorable, yes, but it is not what I expected. I had pictured my sports bag, and I pictured football, basketball, baseball, like this size, and we get this little size. And I think that was because I was looking at the picture online, and pictures represent to us truth, what we think is truth about what we can expect from something or someone. Pictures represent stories or give us a sense of someone or something so that we can begin to form an understanding of that. And sometimes what the picture represents to us is different than the expectations that we form, or sometimes the reality that we see becomes different than the pictures that we see and the expectations that we formed. And Jesus, in a similar way, is a picture of God to us in flesh. Jesus came, God revealed himself through Jesus Christ on earth so that we could get a picture of him, so we could get a sense of him. So last week, we talked about how God is extraordinary, how God is beyond our imagination, how God is difficult for us to even begin to grasp, and all of that is true. But here's the thing, he's also ordinary. He's also different than all of those expectations of extraordinary. And so tonight, we're gonna talk a little bit about that. We're gonna unpack that. We're gonna look at a scene from the Gospel of John. Now John, who wrote the Gospel of John, he was one of Jesus's disciples. He was, in fact, one of Jesus's closest disciples. He spent a lot of time with Jesus, and he knew Jesus really well. So when he wrote his gospel, he wanted people to understand this same Jesus that he had come to know. He wanted to paint a picture or present a picture of this Jesus that he had come to know. So he, in his gospel, he tells us some very specific things about this Jesus. But one of those things is that Jesus is the Messiah from God. God the Father sent his Son into the world so that we could know him. He tells us that in his gospel. But he also says that the people around Jesus missed that truth, missed the fact that he was the Messiah because they had a picture of what the Messiah would be like in their mind. They had an expectation of what the Messiah would be like, and Jesus was very different from that expectation. They expected the Messiah would be this conquering hero, this military power, this guy who is politically influential. And or they might have expected that he was somebody who came up through the religious system, somebody who had some influence and stature within the religious system. And some of them even thought that he might would come from an influential family, somebody who would come with some status, some wealth, some influence within the community and the culture. But the thing is, Jesus came outside of all of that. Jesus came, I would even say, underneath all of those expectations. See, Jesus wasn't born in prominence and wealth and stature. He was born in a barn as a baby. Jesus didn't come from the political system. He challenged that political system. Jesus didn't come concerned about overthrowing the Roman government with military power. So Jesus, when he showed up, he was very different from the people's expectations, and they missed it because their expectations were more than how Jesus presented himself. So tonight we're going to pick up in the Gospel of John, chapter 14. Now let me set this scene a little bit. John 14, Jesus is with his disciples around a table and he's talking with them and he's sharing a dinner with them. In fact, it's a very important dinner. It's the Passover. And Jesus knows that this particular dinner is very significant because he knows his ministry with them, his physical presence with them, is about to end. Jesus knows in just a matter of hours, he's going to be arrested and he's going to be tried and crucified. And so he's preparing his disciples for this disruption, this change. He knows that what's about to happen in the hours to come is going to really disrupt their understanding of what they expected. Now, in chapter 13, leading up to this part that we're going to read in just a second, Jesus tells them, I'm getting ready to go away from you, and where I'm going, you can't go. And he also tells them that one of you is going to betray me. And one of you is even going to deny knowing me. Now I can imagine as the disciples are sitting around this table talking with Jesus and listening to him, they are starting to get a little anxious and nervous and they're looking at each other going, what is he saying? We don't understand. How can he say this? This is not what we expected. And that's where we're going to pick up the conversation. In John 14, verse 1, Jesus says this, do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. Then Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we even know the way? And Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really know me, you will know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. So here's the thing, okay, Jesus starts this conversation with them by saying, do not let your hearts be troubled. I find that really interesting because of course their hearts are troubled. Of course they're disturbed by this because he's saying stuff that disrupts everything they thought was gonna happen. He's saying this Jesus, who they left home, they left jobs, they left families, they left whole communities and livelihoods to follow him, is now saying that he's going away from them and that he's not going to be with them. And where he's going, they can't go yet. And he's saying that all the things that they had put their trust in, like one another and things working out, is going to be disrupted. So of course their hearts are troubled and they get disturbed by this because they don't understand. It doesn't meet their expectations of what it meant to be with Jesus. They had an idea in their head, a picture in their head of how it was going to play out, and it's not playing out that way. Then Thomas, one of the disciples, pipes up, and I love Thomas because he's Mr. Practicality. Like, he likes to try to figure things out and manage things and control things. And he says, Lord, you're telling us that you're going to go prepare a place for us, and we're going to know the way to come to you, to get to you, but you haven't even told us where you're going. So how can we even know the way to get there? See, Thomas is trying to figure it out. He's trying to manage it and put it into fitting into his expectations. And Jesus says, no, you do know the way. I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And this is a really familiar verse to many of us, but it's an extraordinary statement from Jesus, because Jesus is saying in this one statement, he's saying the destination where they're going to be, you're going to be with the Father. And he's saying how to get there. You're going to be able to get there through me. Jesus is saying to his disciples, you can be with the Father. You can know the Father, Father God, Father Extraordinary. You can know him through me. I am him. If you know me, you know him. That's amazing, y'all. But the disciples had trouble grasping this because it was less than what they expected. Jesus was less than what they expected in this sense. And so they struggled with it. They were anxious with it. And here's the thing. I think just like the disciples, we can miss it. We can have trouble grasping the truth of Jesus with us. See, Jesus, God in the flesh, was with the disciples, present right in their midst, and they missed it. And we can miss it too, because we have expectations of God. Like we talked about last week, we expect God extraordinary. We like God extraordinary. We like the God who moves mountains. We like the God who parts waters. We like God who casts the stars into the sky and who has reign and rule over this universe that seems so crazy and bizarre to us. And here's the thing, God is all those things, but He is also God ordinary. He is also God with us in the flesh. But that doesn't always meet our expectations. So here's a really difficult truth for us to grasp. God extraordinary chooses to come and show up in our ordinary so that He can be close to us and so that we can know Him. Let me say that again. God extraordinary chooses to come and show up in our ordinary lives so that we can know Him and He can be close to us. That's amazing, y'all. Just like with the disciples, God reveals Himself through Jesus. In Jesus, we see an ordinary God who cares for ordinary people, who, regardless of their education or their status or their money or wealth or sin, He cares about them. In Jesus, we see a God who cares about our ordinary lives, the troubles that we have, the things that matter to us, the things that we rejoice in, the things that we are sad over. God cares about those things. And in Jesus, we see that God is both extraordinary and rules and reigns, but He's also ordinary, and He presents Himself and He shows up in our lives and He says, I want to be present with you and I want you to know Me. But here's the thing, we have to be willing to open up our expectations of who God is. If we're willing to do that, if we're willing to kind of press in and start to know God personally in our day-to-day lives, what we'll find is that He is more extraordinary than we had ever imagined. See, God is less oftentimes than what we imagine, but that's such great news because it means that He's more present, He's more concerned, He's more invested, He's more personal in our lives than we ever even imagined. So if we're willing to get to know God ordinary, we can discover that extraordinary part of Him. So God is a lot of things, but He's often different or even less than what we expect. And that's good news, because we might expect a God who's a conquering hero who's going to conquer our enemies, but what we find is a God who's a peacemaker to our enemies and changes their lives and ours. We might expect a God who comes up through a political system or a military system, and what we find is a God who challenges those systems. We might expect a God who uses His power or His money to influence, and what we find is a God who reaches out His hand and befriends those who have no power or status or influence, those who are lonely, those who are outcast. We might expect a God who's far off, and what we find is a God who is close, more close than we ever thought. We might expect a God who is judgmental, but what we find is a God who offers forgiveness and grace. We might expect the extraordinary, but what we find is God is ordinary too. How we view God matters, y'all, because it shapes how we relate to Him, it shapes how we relate to one another, it shapes how we see ourselves, and it shapes how we see the situations that we find ourselves in 2021, in COVID-19, in all the political upheaval in our land and in our world. God is present. He is extraordinary God who rules and reigns over those, but He's also God present with us in the midst of our everyday worries and joys and concerns. So tonight, as you go to small groups, I would love for you to talk more about how do we expand our expectations of God? How do we change how we view God to include God as ordinary? How do we press in and get to know Him personally in our ordinary lives so that He can reveal more and more about who He is, extraordinary and ordinary? Talk more about that, and I hope that you guys have a great small group time.